Good afternoon and evening and morning, everyone joining us from around the world. Welcome to all of you. I especially want to invite everyone at the moment, if you can, to introduce yourselves in the chat box. Please let us know who you are, where you're coming from, and who you work with. My name is Jim Barnhart. I'm the assistant to the administrator in the Bureau for Resilience and Food Security at USAID and the deputy co-coordinator of the Feed the Future program that our bureau has the honor to lead from the USG side. We are here to celebrate new members of USAID's advisory committee, BIFAD, recently appointed by President Biden. This is their first public meeting. I'd like to add my personal welcome and greeting to the new members. We're incredibly excited that you're here, and we're looking forward to your guidance as we navigate a new era in food security challenges. I'd like to congratulate BIFAD Chair Dr. Lawrence Alexander, Chancellor of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. Thank you so much for agreeing to lead the board. And congratulations to our BIFAD members, Dr. Pamela Anderson, Director General Emerita of the International Potato Center, Professor Marie Boyd, Associate Professor of Law at the University of South Carolina, Dr. Ratan Lal, Distinguished University Professor of Soil Science at the Ohio State University and the 2020 World Food Prize Laureate. Dr. Sawida Liverpool-Tacey, Associate Professor at the Department of Agriculture, Food and Resource Economics at Michigan State University. Ms. Henri Moore, Vice President and Head of Responsible Business at GSK Consumer Health. And Ms. Kathy Spahn, CEO of the Helen Keller International. A warm welcome to you all. I also want to take a moment to express our deep thanks to our former BIFAD members who've joined today. Former BIFAD chairs, Dr. Mark Keenum, President of Mississippi State University, and Dr. Brady Deaton, Chancellor Emeritus of University of Missouri, are with us today. You honor us with your presence. I also want to thank the former BIFAD members that are here. Dr. Gabiza Ajate, Distinguished Professor of Agronomy at Purdue University. Mr. James Ash, Food and Agribusiness Group Leader at Hush Blackwell LLP. Mr. Richard Lackey, Founder and CEO of World Food Bank Incorporated. Mr. Mark McDaniel, Partner of McDaniel & McDaniel Attorneys LLC. And Mr. David Matthews, Business Development Officer at the United Community Bank. We are truly grateful for your service and for the diverse thought leadership that you've been able to that you have brought as we've convened in support of our mission at USAID. And I'd also like to give a special welcome to another former BIFAD member, Dr. Carrie Fowler, who I believe is also with us today and has recently been appointed the Special Envoy for Global Food Security to the Secretary of State. Wonderful to have you with us, Carrie. And now it's my distinct honor to introduce USAID Administrator Samantha Power for some opening remarks. Over to you, Administrator.
Thanks so much, Jim, and thank you for your leadership and the leadership of so many who have gathered here today. This meeting, I think it's safe to say, could not be more important and could not be better timed. So I feel really pleased to be able to just share a few words with you at the outset. I think it's fair to say that BIFAD was made for this moment in world and human affairs. Like all of you here at USAID, Jim and I and the whole team have spent the last couple of months anticipating the crisis at our doorstep. And again, it just seems like exactly the right occasion to come together to discuss steps to protect and strengthen global food security in light of spikes in food, fuel, and fertilizer prices that you know all too well. Spikes that predated Putin's war on Ukraine, but that obviously have become much more severe in light of that horrific decision and horrific ongoing campaign. For nearly 50 years, the Board for International Food and Agricultural Development has been a critical partner for USAID. It has drawn on America's universities to support a global transformation of agriculture and food systems that now feed twice as many people as they did in 1975, using breakthroughs that have saved countless lives and helped lift billions of people out of poverty. As many of you know, our nation's historically Black colleges and universities, the HBCUs, and other minority-serving institutions have been really important contributors to this event. That is why I have made it a priority for USAID to ramp up our engagement with minority-serving institutions. I've had the chance to visit Delaware State, Alcorn State, Tuskegee, most recently, University of Maryland, Eastern Shore, and as well, the largest Hispanic-serving institution in the country, Florida International University. We could not be more excited about deepening the relationship between USAID and minority-serving institutions so that they can continue to apply the deep well of expertise that they have on campus to the world's challenges in agriculture, nutrition, and food security. So while it is long overdue, it is especially important today that we acknowledge and celebrate BIFAD's first board chair from an HBCU, Chancellor of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, Dr. Lawrence Alexander. Thank you so much, Dr. Alexander, for leading this board at such an important moment. Like Jim, I want to thank all of our board members, past and present, for your expertise, your wisdom, and your focus on leveraging America's talent and innovation to address today's food crisis and build resilience for the future. Today's geopolitical tensions and surging fuel prices recall a time not long ago during the energy crisis of the 1970s. And recall that it was against this backdrop in 1975 when Congress enacted the Famine Prevention and Freedom from Hunger Amendment to the Foreign Assistance Act, which established BIFAD and charged USAID to call upon the nation's best talent, its universities, to address challenges of famine and food security. What followed has become a proud legacy of collaboration with BIFAD's stakeholder community, U.S. universities, the private sector, and our international partners, in essence, all of you. Together with local communities and partner governments, our efforts have helped countries raise their agricultural productivity, making food more affordable to the poor and helping millions of families sell more crops, grow their incomes, and improve their diets. Then just a few years ago, rates of extreme poverty and acute malnutrition began to rise, in large part due to protracted conflicts and climate change impacts, which are growing by the year, exacerbated, needless to say, by market impacts brought about by COVID-19. I recount this history because we are, I think, at another inflection point, one that requires us to bring the full weight of American ingenuity to bear to strengthen global food security and avert what really could be catastrophic consequences. We're about to enter the fourth month of the Russian Federation's brutal campaign of violence in Ukraine, and estimates show that up to 40 million additional people could be pushed into poverty and food insecurity this year as a result of Putin's war. I don't have to remind all of you that shocks to humanitarian and food systems, again, did not start with the war in Ukraine. Last year alone, more than 193 million people worldwide experienced acute food insecurity, and that was an increase of 40 million from the previous year. The added shocks are causing massive disruptions in the global food system, further increasing prices of food, fertilizer, and fuel. And while the extent of the impacts from this array of challenges is uncertain, the United States and our partners are working both inside Ukraine and around the world to support the countries and the people who are the most at risk. USAID is scaling up emergency food, health, and livelihood assistance to tens of millions of people likely to fall into food insecurity due to the combined effects of the war, the pandemic, and the climate crisis. In the last few months alone, the United States has contributed nearly $1.7 billion to West African countries affected by food shortages and conflict in the Sahel, Lake Chad Basin regions, and Yemen. Across government, there are sustained multilateral and bilateral efforts underway to try to keep trade open, limit export controls, and mitigate further disruptions. But this is a very, very challenging time. In recent weeks, I've met personally with public and private sector leads from around the world to identify ways that philanthropy, NGOs, and corporations can help address immediate disruptions, mitigate the global fertilizer shortage, and increase investments in agricultural capacity and resilience. But bringing to bear the full weight of American ingenuity, of course, means going beyond crisis response to developing lasting solutions to age-old challenges, funding the latest research and technology, and engaging intensively with our nation's agricultural experts. The Green Revolution spurred innovations that drastically improved agricultural and nutritional yields, delivered cutting-edge conservation and land use techniques, and developed cultivation and storage methods to lengthen the shelf life of crops. Inspired by America's own success in providing new technologies and practices to its farmers, this community that's gathered here today helped us bring these innovations to the rest of the world. Today's challenges call for a redoubling of these efforts. And because of your work and our decades-long partnership, we already have successful models to accelerate and expand upon. Following severe food price spikes in 2008, USAID launched America's Global Hunger and Food Security Initiative, Feed the Future, to equip countries to tackle the root causes of food insecurity and malnutrition within their own borders. The key to unleashing American ingenuity is the work being done at more than 20 Feed the Future innovation labs across the country to develop novel solutions to stubborn agricultural productivity challenges. These labs have already developed drought-tolerant varieties of staple crops that have been deployed across 13 African countries and developed a software application that helps Nepalese dairy farmers, for example, formulate more nutritious, less expensive feeding rations to increase milk production. These are innovations that Feed the Future has harnessed to help lift an estimated 23.4 million people out of poverty. We cannot afford to lose this momentum decades in the making, which is why last year, the United States committed $10 billion to fight hunger and food insecurity. Half of that is being invested here in the US, with the other half meant to expand Feed the Future's work to fight global food insecurity, helping smallholder farmers, their families, and their communities escape poverty. This commitment will build on Feed the Future's decade of progress, generating new collaborative innovation labs with a greater engagement of HBCUs and minority-serving institutions, combining local knowledge with cutting-edge technology to develop climate-smart agricultural solutions that are going to boost productivity and resilience. It is critical that these efforts are informed by this community of researchers and innovators. So I want to thank BIFAD, really from the bottom of my heart, for your work to develop the report and policy recommendations on agricultural productivity growth in sub-Saharan Africa that we received over the weekend. There may never be a moment like this one, when so much of the world's attention is galvanized on food security and preventing a global food crisis. Together, we have to do all we can to seize this moment and envision new ways to overcome today's particular crisis, which is very, very significant, and work together at the same time to eventually end global hunger and malnutrition in the medium and longer term. With that, I will turn the floor back to Jim, and thank you again for coming at this time of all times.
Thank you, Administrator Power. Thank you very much. Very inspiring remarks, and certainly galvanizes the team, I'm sure, for the business meeting. I know that you need to run. Feel free to stay as long as you can, but know that your schedule is incredibly busy. So at this point, it's my great pleasure to hand the meeting over to Chair Alexander to take us forward. Over to you.
Thank you, Jim, for that warm introduction. And thank you, Administrator Power. I'm honored that you joined us today to share your remarks. I would like to add my deep and sincere appreciation to the recent BIFAD members for your service and leadership on the board. Your vision and work have contributed greatly to USAID's strategic direction and program implementation. We look forward to building on this legacy. I'm looking forward to building a fruitful working relationship between USAID and BIFAD, and also to coalescing around work streams important to our shared vision of reducing poverty and eliminating hunger. Before we begin, I would like to acknowledge other distinguished guests in today's meeting, including former BIFAD members and Special Envoy for Global Food Security, to the Secretary of State, Dr. Carrie Fowler. USAID's Deputy Administrator for Policy and Programming, Ambassador Isabel Coleman, and the Director of the Center of Excellence for Global Food Security and Defense, Dr. Moses Cairo, at the University of Maryland, Eastern Shore. I would like to also recognize each of the participants in the Zoom room today. I see from the poll that we have participants from around the world, with registered attendees from 22 countries, over 55 different organizations representing universities, USAID, other government agencies, the private sector, and implementers. Your participation in today's event will certainly enrich our discussion and inform the board's work. Again, my name is Lawrence Alexander, and I'm Chancellor of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, an 1890 public land-grant university. I'm honored to serve as BIFAD chair and encouraged to work with this diverse committee. As Administrator Power mentioned in her welcoming remarks, BIFAD is a 7-member presidentially appointed advisory board to USAID, established to ensure that USAID brings the assets of the US universities to bear on the development challenges in agriculture and food security and supports their representation in USAID programming. This January, President Biden reinvigorated the board with the appointment of new members who each bring a wealth and diversity of experience and expertise. And I would like to invite the board members to introduce themselves at this time, beginning with Pamela Anderson. Pamela.
Thank you, Dr. Alexander. Hello, everyone. I'm Pamela Anderson, the Director General Emerita of the International Potato Center, which is one of the CGIAR centers. I'm specialized in vector entomology and epidemiology. For 4 decades, I lived in Latin America and initially worked with the national programs in Central America. And then once I joined the CG system, worked globally in Latin America, Sub-Saharan Africa, and Asia, always on food security and poverty reduction with smallholder farmers. I've had the honor of serving on BIFAD since 2015, and it's a joy to be with you all today. Thank you.
Thank you, Pamela. Marie Boyd is also a member. She could not be with us today, but she is the associate professor at the University of South Carolina School of Law, and her research areas include food law and policy and administrative law. This time I'll call on Ratan Lal.
Thank you, Dr. Alexander. I'm Ratan Lal, Distinguished Professor of Soil Science and Director of the CFAAS Ratan Lal Center for Carbon Management and Sequestration. I've been at Ohio State since 1987. And was at the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture, a CGIAR center at Ibadan, Nigeria for 18 years. My research interest is making agriculture a solution to climate change adaptation and mitigation through recarbonization of the soil and the terrestrial biosphere. It's a pleasure to be a member of the BIFAD.
Thank you, Ratan. This time we'll call on Sawita.
Thank you, Dr. Alexander, and good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone. I'm Sawita Liverpool-Tassier. I'm an associate professor of agricultural economics in the Department of Agriculture, Food, and Resource Economics at Michigan State University. I was a postdoctoral fellow at the International Food Policy Research Institute and have over 20 years experience working on food systems transformation in Sub-Saharan Africa. And my research interests remain around food systems transformation in Sub-Saharan Africa, and particularly how the dynamism in the food systems transformation creates opportunities for households and entrepreneurs along food value chains. And it's an honor to be on BIFAD. Thank you.
Thank you, Sawita. Henri?
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Henri Moore, and I lead and head our responsible business function at the new Smith Kline company. It's GSK Smith Kline, and we will be called Halion. And so formerly though, I worked with Corteva AgriScience, where I worked diligently with smallholder farmers to improve livelihoods. So it's a pleasure to be here with you today and a pleasure to be on BIFAD. Thank you.
Thank you, Henri. Kathy?
Hello, everybody. I'm Kathy Spahn, and I'm president and CEO of Helen Keller International and also a board member of the Access to Nutrition Initiative. And my focus is really on ensuring that nutrition is central to all the discussions we have about worldwide hunger and food security.
Thank you, Kathy. I am so honored to serve alongside such a distinguished group of scholars, and thank you so very much. I appreciate you. As this is our first public meeting, I want to take just a couple minutes at the start to share an overview of our current work plan, priorities, and upcoming initiatives. Over the past 3 months, informed by discussions with Administrator Power and other agency leaders, the board has developed a work plan to guide our activities over the next 2 years, while also accounting for the need to remain responsive to emerging priorities. Overall, we are committed to providing evidence-based recommendations to USAID and the broader development community to inform strategy, policy, and programming that build resilient and sustainable food and nutrition systems to reduce extreme poverty and malnutrition in a changing climate. The board aims to accomplish this goal using several overarching principles of engagement, including ensuring knowledge generation and engagements are inclusive, committing to evidence-centered knowledge generation and advice, and aiming to accelerate bringing innovative ideas and products into social and economic use. In our work planning, we have prioritized 3 key global challenges to address. First, we see it as critical to bring forward evidence-based recommendations to strengthen agricultural and food systems to respond to global food security crises and to mitigate the impacts of shocks, including shocks caused by conflicts, pandemic, and climate change. We're seeing yet another example of the fragility of global food systems in the second order impacts of Russia's war in Ukraine and resultant disrupted markets and increased food insecurity in developing countries. BIFAD hopes to play a role in helping to identify short, medium, and long-term opportunities to address the current global food security crisis and to address the bigger questions of how we build food resilient food systems that are the insurance against these shocks. Our work in the area begins with today's discussions as we take stock of the evidence around agricultural and food systems resilience and identify the weak links to address in order to prepare systems to respond or adapt to shocks. Second, our work plan prioritizes evidence gathering around improving the affordability of safe and nutritious foods. Nutrition is foundational to development. Ensuring safe and affordable nutrition is one of the most cost-effective ways to save lives and is essential to health, productivity, gender equity, and other goals. Yet there are currently more than 3 billion people on the planet who cannot afford a minimally nutritious diet. More than 149 million children suffer from stunting. We have noted Administrator Power's wish to ensure integration of sectors across USAID. Nutrition is a great integrator as working to ensure good nutrition brings together multiple sectors, including health, agriculture and food systems, water, humanitarian relief and resilience, among others. Women who worldwide are highly engaged in production, processing, distribution, and preparation of food are central to ensuring good nutrition. Focusing on the affordability of nutritious foods also promotes women's empowerment and gender equity. We hope that our work will inform a cross-sector, whole of agency approach to tackle the challenge of delivering safe, nutritious, affordable foods in Feed the Future target countries and nutrition priority countries. Finally, as BIFAD's third focal issue, we are committed to preparing evidence-based recommendations for strategies and programs to adapt to and mitigate climate change in agricultural and food systems. The impact of climate change will be devastating for our planet. Agriculture is both hard hit by, but also contributes significantly to, climate change. We believe BIFAD can play an important role in helping to identify the most cost-effective climate change adaptation and mitigation measures in agriculture and food systems. This would include working to develop and incentivize locally led innovations for smallholder farmers to boost productivity, enhance nutrient value, improve food safety, and prolong shelf life and innovations for other midstream or downstream agricultural value chain actors, e.g. traders and processors. In fact, today we will announce new work relating to systemic solutions for climate change adaptations and mitigation in agriculture, nutrition, and food systems to inform the implementation of the recently released Climate Change 2022 to 2030. We look forward to working with talented experts from around the world, including those in the Zoom room today, to refine the board's focus, to gather and synthesize evidence, to respond to these challenges. Your comments are invited to further inform BIFAD's work. That brings us to today's meeting. This public meeting aligns with BIFAD's first work stream on strengthening food systems resilience, and also our third work stream around climate change adaptation and mitigation in agriculture, nutrition, and food systems. In the face of short-term and long-term shocks, fragile food systems are driving increases in poverty, hunger, and child stunting. The global effort to end hunger and poverty is at a critical moment, and Russia's invasion of Ukraine, adding to an already compounded global food crisis as countries struggle to recover from the impacts of COVID-19, humanitarian emergencies, and climate change. Today's meeting responds to the current global food security crisis. Intended as a stock-taking initiative, presentations and discussions will explore the evidence-based and lessons from the past to strengthen agricultural nutrition and food systems in the face of shocks. I want to note that BIFAD, as the Federal Advisory Committee, includes public comment periods in this public meetings. And these are a wonderful opportunity for us to hear directly from stakeholders on the issues before the board. We invite the public to ask questions in the Q&A box and make comments in the chat for consideration by the board and speakers today. We will try to answer as many questions as we can. We also look forward to posting official minutes of these proceedings on USAID's BIFAD website following this event. And please know that your comments and questions will form part of the official public record. At this point, I'm pleased to welcome Pamela Anderson to share framing remarks to present the key questions for our discussion. Pamela's vision for today's meeting and her leadership were central to putting together this stellar program and panel of speakers and presenters today. Thank you, Pamela. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Alexander. So as you've heard this morning, the current new BIFAD was just appointed by President Biden in January. Just as we were getting to work on our work plan, the war on Ukraine broke out. So our first thought is we should develop a work stream to specifically focus on the implications for food security of the war and potential USAID responses. But as the board started to really discuss and deliberate, what we realized is that for the past 15 years, we have moved from crises to crises. So, for example, the 2008 food price crises, and then again in 2011, Arab Spring in 2010, the drought in the Horn of Africa in 2011, Ebola outbreaks in West Africa in 2014, emerging pest and disease problems in many places, COVID, and still reeling from COVID, now we're faced with this new global food fertilizer and food price crisis. And we understand that the drought in the Horn of Africa that we're seeing could be the worst in 40 years. So it's just been a series of shocks for a smallholder farmer in East Africa who's cultivating the staple crop maize. Since 2010, she has been faced, for example, with an emerging disease outbreak of maize lethal necrosis virus, followed by an emerging insect pest outbreak, the fall armyworm, followed by a plague of locusts, and then COVID, and now the food fertilizer and price crisis. It's becoming unbearable. We're moving from crisis to crisis. For many households and communities, it is a wave of simultaneous crisis. So it feels as if we are moving into a new reality of chronic crisis, which is a truly tragic oxymoron. So for BIFAD, then the question really became, how do we get out in front of these crises? How do we understand and strengthen our food and nutrition systems so that they are resilient to this nonstop set of shocks, whether they're driven from political conflict, global pandemics, emerging pest and disease, or severe weather events? So that is how we defined the first work stream that we want to take up. Now, starting into this work, because food and nutrition systems are complex systems, we're starting with a working hypothesis that more or less says, if we can understand the weak areas, the weak nodes in these complex systems, that might offer us some strategic entry points for building greater resilience back into the systems. So today, what we wanted to start is an exploration by looking back to see what have we learned? What is the evidence? Where is the evidence and the lessons learned from our previous crises? What pieces in the food and nutrition systems have collapsed when they've been hit by these different shocks? And we've intentionally brought together a diverse panel of speakers for the session today, including voices that we don't normally explicitly listen to. So in addition to a food policy perspective, because all of these crises eventually become nutritional crises, we will hear from a nutrition perspective. We had invited the general manager of Premium Cassava Limited in Nigeria, but unfortunately, Nike Tinubu had a last minute conflict and had to drop out. But we wanted to take a look at the private sector perspective on food systems and supply chains and how they are responding to these shocks. So we will get back to that, but not this morning. BIFAD's work has traditionally focused on USAID's development portfolio, but for the focal area this morning, we really think it's critical that we pull in explicitly the humanitarian aid and assistance perspective. And so we'll be hearing from one of the members of Mercy Corps. And in the BIFAD work plan, as Dr. Alexander explained, we have made a serious and explicit commitment to elevate women's inclusion and empowerment across all of the work that we do. So we'll also hear this morning a gender perspective to look at how women's inclusion and empowerment can strengthen our food and nutrition systems. So we want to reemphasize this is just our starting point and thank all of you who have joined us today. Our request is that you engage actively with us on this, your questions for the Q&A session, but also feedback after the session. And any of you that have publications or reports from your organizations or your network that point to these sources of lessons learned and evidence on how this continual set of shocks is affecting our food systems, we would be grateful to receive those from you. So thank you again for joining us. Now, as we welcome our expert panel of presenters today, I am extremely pleased to introduce our first invited speaker, Dr. Maximo Torero. Maximo is the chief economist at the United Nations Food and Agricultural Organization, FAO. Maximo's presentation will review what we know about the extent and magnitude of the current food security crisis, while also pointing to parallels between the current crises and former global shocks, including the 1973 and the 2011 food price crises. Maximo, welcome. The virtual floor is yours.
Hey, thank you. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure for me to be here. And let me share my screen. I will try to do an effort on trying to bring some of the elements that you have been raising and look to an overview of the past and the current global food crisis. So let me start first with the photo of today so that we understand the context over which we are looking at. So today we are facing a problem of COVID-19 pandemic and the consequences, economic slowdowns and downturns as a result of COVID-19, which have been exacerbated because of the conflict and the war. But also we have conflict, climate variability and extremes, which are something which is permanent and which should be prepared for it. And all of these have affected the cost and affordability of healthy diets, which also bring another context, which is how the market is structured and how the incentives are today in the markets. All of these underline causes of poverty and significant inequality. This is what we call the major drivers and underlying factors, which are challenging us and which keep challenging us since the previous crisis too. There's a permanent, although we call it COVID-19 pandemic, there could be many other shocks that could put us in the situation that we are facing today. Now, how we are looking at this, and we are looking at this in terms of basic risks. And risk is when we know the probability distribution of the potential effect, but also uncertainties, which are cases where we don't know the probability distribution of the damage. That was clearly at the beginning the case of COVID-19 and potential future shocks that we could have similar to COVID-19. But how they affect the agri-food systems and how we look at it. So we have separated them in three blocks, what we call food in agriculture, macro risk, and humanitarian risks. And all of those three dimensions are affected by water stress and by climate change today. On the food of agriculture, we have what we call the production, of course, which is related to the input supplies, is related to the trade, and is related to the logistics and infrastructure. This is something that became extremely relevant during COVID-19, how important the logistics part were when we were looking at the agri-food systems. Of course, diseases and disease proliferation, which could be also impacted by the changes in climate, and how all of those five elements will affect prices, of course, as an output. In terms of the macro aspect, one of the new things that we're looking now is, of course, energy inputs and biofuels. Before, we used to look at the competition between for food and biofuels, but now the energy prices also came stronger with a different dimension on how they affect the production of fertilizers. The macroeconomic conditions are also central, and it's not only debt and economic growth, which I referred before as slowdowns and downturns, but also exchange rates, and also potential risk of nuclear contamination. And finally, the humanitarian aspect, which brings the food, migration, of course, and refugees, which have an impact, and is something that has been occurring internationally, but also locally through displaced populations. And all of these, as I mentioned before, are affected by water stress and climate change. Now, in this context, the photo that we have today is a situation which we report here based on our global crisis report released in May the 4th, that by 2021, around 193 million people were in crisis or worse. And here I'm highlighting the countries by the intensity of the countries which are in IPC3 or above. We have 570,000 people in four countries in catastrophe situation, which is IPC5. And in total, we have 236.2 million people in 41 countries which were in stress, which means IPC phase two and above. And this is also reflected in long-term impacts, which are the levels of chronic undernourishment that we face, how the pandemic also has challenged the eradication of hunger, increased extreme poverty, and the 3 billion people that don't have access to healthy diets today. And not only that, a world which is not on track to achieve global nutrition targets. And some progress has been made, but effects of the pandemic on nutrition will cause serious setbacks in the future. Now, in this context, if we want to measure resilience, and I am going to look at one of the dimensions of resilience, which is the absorptive capacity, there are several indicators that we have been developing. One is on primary production. The other one is on food supply, which is the dietary sourcing flexibility index, transport networks, which is linked to logistics, and economic access to healthy diets. Let me just focus on the second one, on the food supply. This food supply, which we call the dietary sourcing flexibility index, in a certain sense, turns the previous indicator around because it looks and captures the multiplicity of different pathways through which a unit of food can be made available to a consumer. The diversity of pathways of food supply has three components: the diversity of domestic production for the domestic market or to be exported, the diversity of imports and trade partners, and the diversity of food stocks held from previous years. Again, in this example, country B has a higher absorptive capacity than country A, because not only does country B produce a more diverse set of agricultural commodities and holds a more diverse set of food reserves, but also imports from more countries a more diverse set of products. And the more the options in terms of sourcing food, the higher the absorptive capacity the country will have. And this is extremely relevant today, for example, with the shock that we are facing because of the war in Ukraine. And here I just show the major results. And you will see that in green, we have the high income countries. All of them are in the top side, which have significant diversity in both dimensions and greater absorptive capacity. The blue are the upper middle income countries with more variance across the different elements, something to look carefully. The lower middle income countries more close to the bottom. And of course, the low income countries will show a very low capacity of absorption. And this is the challenge because this trend is not only today, but has been historically the evolution. There has been some improvements, but this incapacity of absorption is present in low income countries and lower middle income countries, and even in some upper middle income countries. Now, what is the past and the present for cereals? Let me show you here one of the elements which personally I believe is central in when we look at the market structure on commodity exports. Here I'm looking in the left-hand side, the food crisis 2007, 2008, and 2011. And this was the market concentration of the top five countries in terms of exports for maize. They managed 84%, for wheat 63%, for rice 95%, and for other rice, so we have paddy and broken rice, 80%. As you can see, very few countries control most of the export in that time, and that's why droughts that affected Australia and other parts of the world created the food crisis in 2007, 2008, and 2011. If we look at today, we're facing exactly the same challenge. There has been some improvement. There has been new countries coming to play again. And this is the case of Ukraine and Russian Federation, which has increased their share in terms of their export share of the world. But again, these two countries share in cereals around 30% of the exports in the world. And there are other three or four countries that control the remaining, meaning that level of concentration has improved, but not at the level we need to improve. And here I'm showing the evolution between 1990 and today. So to look at the change, so the combined change of million metric tons for the case of the European Union and USA is a negative 7 million metric tons. The combined change for China and Indonesia is a positive 12 million metric tons. The combined change between Russia and Ukraine is a positive 66 million metric tons. So these two countries came to play a bigger role and others reduced the role, but the concentration remained high. Similarly, with Australia, Canada, and Argentina, positive 2 million metric tons, and a significant decline for the case of Africa and Asia, which is a shocking result, minus 62 million metric tons. So this is showing to us that what we are facing today, which is significant amount of countries, 50 countries, because of the Ukraine war, of Russia Federation on Ukraine, have around 50 countries have around 30% of their share of the imports on wheat from these two countries. And of those, 30 has more than 50% of their share of the imports, shows how vulnerable we are with this concentration. Even more, I plot here in the stars of different colors, the emergency countries, the 43 countries we were talking about. And in red, in the star red, you have the case of Madagascar, you have the case of Yemen, and you have the case of Ethiopia, which are also countries that have even 570,000 population in IPC5 or above. and also the other cases of the Global Food Crisis Report. Now, it's important also to understand that wheat is not the major commodity for sub-Saharan Africa. Here I am showing the kilocalorie per capita per day. In green color, you will see the low level of consumption of wheat in the case of sub-Saharan Africa. But despite this, wheat and maize are feedstock, and they also affect animal feed and therefore all derivatives from other types of foods. As a result, it's not because of wheat specifically, wheat consumption, but it's because of the increase in the food prices that this will affect these countries. And what we are observing today when we look at the different commodities, agriculture, fertilizers, energy, metals and minerals, that this concentration of the export, key exporting countries, has been behind many of the spikes, the different spikes across history of these commodities, including also the case of fertilizers. Now, what is happening in fertilizers and why it's so important? A similar story. If we look at fertilizers, we will see that there is a high concentration of world fertilizer production capacity by country. Here I'm showing the graph of urea, DAP, potash, and NPK. In all these pie charts, you will see that there is a significant concentration in very few players: China, India, Indonesia, Russia, Belarus, in many of the commodities. Even in NPK, we will see Russia Federation today concentrates a significant part of the exports of these fertilizers. But not only is the concentration across the world, but it's also the concentration within the countries. Here we are plotting within the countries the level of concentration of how many companies control the total production. If you look at potash, only one company controls in most of the countries the total production. And in China, there is only one, more than one. But in most of the cases, the concentration is extremely high. In the case of NPK, Russia Federation is the first exporter of nitrogen, the second exporter of phosphorus, and the third of potassium. So the second of potassium, sorry, and the third of phosphorus. So clearly, this reflection of concentration also is present in the fertilizer sector. Now, one new element which differentiates the crisis of today is that before, in the 2007-2011, the major link was with biofuels in the bottom part of this chart, the competition between feedstock to biofuels. Today, we have a new element, which is the competition with gas and energy, and that has ended in high food prices. This new element is a relationship of a different market, the energy market, with the food market that we didn't have before. And that's because to produce nitrogen, you need gas. And if the price of gas goes up, the price of the fertilizers will go up. And as a result, we observe a significant historical increase in terms of the price of fertilizers, but also because of this increase in the prices of gas. And this is something unique that we couldn't find before historically in previous crises. Now, what is the result of this? The result of this is a huge reduction in affordability. Despite the food prices are going up, the affordability of fertilizers is going down more, and therefore this is restricting access to fertilizers. It's not only an issue of availability because of the restrictions of Russian Federation, but also of access because of the increasing prices. Trade is a different story and also a very important story. And here I compare the COVID-19, which is the blue bar, where there was a significant increase on export restrictions at the beginning, but then immediately settled down. The food price crisis of 2008, where there was an exacerbation of prices and it arrived to a level of higher, and this is in the vertical axis, we have the number of calories exported. It increased, but today we are observing in the Ukraine crisis also that this is starting to accumulate. More than 60 countries today have certain types of export restrictions. And this is extremely relevant because while food and agriculture trade became more balanced and resilient on the aggregate, there are still considerable dependencies at product level, especially in the staple foodstuffs. So countries with many links by country and product, which source a large variety of food and agricultural products from many different exporters, are located on the right tail of the curves. Those with a high concentration of their imports on few products and exporters on the left tail. So trade was highly concentrated on few products and countries in 1995. And since then there have been some improvement, but improvement is still not enough. And why is this so important? Because if we look at access to healthy diets, we will see that many of the food groups that are needed are not present in most of the food crisis countries and in most of sub-Saharan Africa. So trade is of essence. If we don't accelerate trade globally and intra-regional trade, we won't be able to achieve this global access to healthy diets and the nutrition outcomes that we want to achieve. Now, the question is what to do. And our focus has been in working in more than one driver and the formulation of portfolios. And here I'm just showing six entry points that we believe are key transformation elements: humanitarian development and peace nexus, not only looking at assistance, but also at production, scale up climate resilience, strengthen economic resilience, lower the cost of nutritious foods along the supply chains, address poverty and inequality, and shift to sustainable consumption patterns. Now, these require building portfolios that bring into account the agri-food systems that we are operating, the environmental systems, the health systems, social protection systems, and other relevant systems. And for that, we need to look at the trade-offs. And that's where modeling could play a significant role. But we believe also that there are three accelerators that are central: technology, data and innovation, and also what we call complements, which includes governments and institutions and human capital. Why? Because they will help us to make it more inclusive. Now, the agri-food system transformation that is requires needs to move from silos to a system-wide approach. Today, we cannot work on one dimension only. We have to look across the different portfolios. That's why the six entry points. And there could be more than six. But that's where we need to bring together all these elements into this agri-food system transformation to try to formulate packages that will help countries. And that's what the Food System Summit tried to do with the transformation pathways, so that we can accelerate this process. There is enormous space to gain inefficiencies in the way we produce, in bringing more resilience through new technologies, but also inefficiencies in reducing food loss and waste, and in the way we also use inputs like fertilizers and pesticides. So significant challenges which are common in the previous crisis, but differences which are important. Clearly today, we don't have a problem of food availability. The food is there, the fertilizers are there. The problem is that they cannot move out. But again, we need to find solutions to increase resilience so that this doesn't happen in the future and we don't have this high level of concentrations in the inputs. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Maximo, for that wonderful presentation. Gave us a thorough look at and a deep dive in a very short period of time, in a very brief and consolidated fashion, proposed solutions as well to many of these interconnected and cross-cutting issues. Thank you. I would like to, at this time, open the floor for my fellow BIFAD members to share their reflections or offer questions for Maximo. For those attending in the audience, please share your questions using the Q&A panel in Zoom. We will respond to as many questions as possible in the next Q&A session. For this round of questions, I do wanna ask our BIFAD members. Kathy, any questions?
Just quickly, an excellent presentation, and I think your closing point that there's no lack in terms of global food availability is a really essential point. One thing that I think time didn't permit you to touch on, and we may not have time now, is the element of dietary modification, about changing diets, changing what people consume so that they're still healthy diets, and that would lessen the impact of malnutrition. Whole other topic area.
Thank you. Henri?
I'm sorry, I did not have a question.
That's good. That's okay. Thank you, Sawita. No questions from Sawita? As you know, Marie is not here. However, Marie did submit a question. In terms of understanding the current state of food insecurity, what are the unknowns? Are there any knowledge or information gaps or areas where it would be helpful to have additional research? If so, please explain. And then I'll go to Pamela.
Thank you, Lawrence. Maximo, that was wonderful. Thank you for kicking us off. When you talk about diversification, I understand you're talking about the diversification of trading partners. You know, what are the conversations that FAO is having with partner countries about actually diversifying the production of foodstuffs within the country? Thanks, Lawrence.
Okay. Thank you, Pamela. I want to give Maximo time to respond. Maximo?
Thank you so much for the nice questions. Regarding the question of Kathy on dietary modification, I think that's central, and that's one of the entry points of the six I put, which are important, and for us it's access to healthy diets. Now, how we are looking at this? One way to look at this is what we call repurposing of incentives, of subsidies. So significant amount of the subsidies are allocated to cereals and not to other commodities and high-value commodities. And that's something that we need to assess to see how we can repurpose those. Now, the question here is that most of the repurposing will be very effective in the high-income countries, but not necessarily in the low and low-middle-income countries. In those countries, what seems to be in the last simulations that we have done that will come out in our next OFI publication, what seems to be working more is the demand side. So how we can provide incentives through the demand so that we increase the demand of this diversity of diet, diversity of nutritious food, that the producer will respond to it rather than providing directly incentives to producers that could be not cost effective. So it's a very complex issue, but I think there is a lot of window of opportunity. And what we are observing today is clearly giving us also a window of opportunity because our concern is cereals. Why we don't take this as an opportunity to start switching more and creating the incentives to switch diets to more diverse nutritious diets. Regarding the question on unknowns, there are many unknowns. There are many data gaps. For example, we are working and we are starting the process to collect data. We know the supply of food, but we don't know the demand. What are the macronutrients demand of food? And that is really important because it will alert us where are the gaps. One first shot is the global map I show you, which is basically telling us how much of the 9 food groups that we need are there. But that is the supply side. But it will be ideal to also understand the demand side so that we understand where the gaps are and where trade facilitation and trade flows could create the benefits that we're looking and where we need to produce more and increase diversity of diets. Now, many of the elements that we are referring to could refer to risks, as I mentioned. But there is the concept of uncertainty, which means something could happen that we don't expect, and we don't know the potential impact on the agricultural sector. And this could be very closely related to climate, because the changes in temperatures and the changes in availability of water could change the way pests and diseases operate. And that could create a significant effect on our production in the future. And we don't know too much of the distribution probability of that potential impact. So huge uncertainties are there. And that's why we keep saying that agriculture is becoming one of the sectors that we have to operate under risk and uncertainty. We need to look at the expectations, no longer at the event happening. We need to look at probability distributions so that we better understand what is the potential impacts. Pamela, in terms of the diversification of trade, yes, exactly. What we are saying is we need to diversify and have more countries that produce more and have surpluses to export. So that if something happens to one country in the world because of climate or because of another reason, there are other countries that come up and can respond to that, what we call supply response of other countries. We are trying to work with our different countries in the different regions. I was lucky to be in all the 5 regional conferences to try to see where there are opportunities. We have an initiative called Hand in Hand, which is exactly trying to do that, looking at areas through territorial approaches in countries where there is significant agricultural potential, but for some reason, farmers are far from achieving it. And this is potential that will move them out of poverty. So basically, they can be at $7 per capita per day, PPP, but today they are less than 1.3 or 1.5. So what will that create in terms of diversity of production in the world will be something substantial. And sometimes the solutions are simple. Sometimes the solutions are very complex. We are operating right now in 52 countries in the world, in Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, Asia, and Latin America to try to find this type of solution. So that's the way we are operating right now at FAO to accelerate this process. Thank you.
Maximo, thank you so much for your responses, but I'm so sorry. It looks like I inadvertently overlooked one of our board members, Ratan. I want you to go ahead and give your question at this time.
You're muted, Ratan.
Maximo, thank you. I have just brief comments. Number one, the COVID and the conflict have taught us to increase strength of the local food production systems so that the disruptions impact is much less. Therefore, I would say urban farming would be very important part to achieve food security, so the disruption are less. The second point I want to make is, rather than producing more all the time, let's focus on nutrition-sensitive agriculture. Food which is nutrient-rich, more than 2 billion people suffer from malnutrition and are nutrition-rich. And the third part which I would like to mention is that healthy diet always comes from healthy soil. And that disconnect has caused a lot of problems. The important concept which need to be mentioned is that the health of soil, plants, animal, people, ecosystem, and the planet is one and indivisible. And that link we should not forget. And lastly, I want to mention is producing more from less. We must save natural resources for nature. 5 billion hectares of land under agriculture is far more than what we need. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that comment, Ratan. And Maximo, did you want to respond?
No, I fully agree with your comment, Ratan. I think the producing more with less is essential. For example, what is happening right now of the shortage of fertilizers is a huge opportunity in the other side of the coin to use fertilizers more efficiently. And that's, for example, the work with soil maps and to understand how much we really need a one combination of NPK. Not only that, I have been looking at this very carefully, and there seems to be options in which we can even change the mix that we do over time in terms of fertilizer applications. So there are a lot of options to improve and to work with manure combined with NPK so that we can assure effectiveness in terms of yields, and which will allow us to not be so dependent at the level we are. So it's basically reducing waste and losses in fertilizers as we should do with food. No?
Maximo, thank you so much for that response and also for your excellent presentation today. We've all enjoyed it, and we thank you for all of your contributions to this meeting. I'd like to, at this time, in the interest of time, and to move on and allow some of our other invited presenters to come in today, we'd like to move on, if we could, to the next panel. In part two, we talk about identifying lessons learned, identifying gaps and key actions to prepare for future crises, to build resilient food systems. Here to present evidence of lessons learned, gaps, and key actions needed to prepare for those is our expert panel. I should note that one of our speakers, Ms. Nike Tinobu, had an unexpected conflict and is unable to join us today. So the timing in the agenda may shift a bit, allowing more time for audience interaction with our speakers and members. First, please welcome Professor Patrick Webb. Patrick is the Alexander McFarland Professor of Nutrition at Tufts University and is the director of the Feed the Future Innovation Lab on Nutrition. Glad to have you join us today. And I'm going to turn it over to you now, Patrick.
Thank you, Dr. Alexander, and thank you to all the BIFAD members, Administrator Powell, and to Maximo for setting the scene. In fact, I was trying to think when I last heard the words nutrition and diet spoken so often outside of a nutrition-specific meeting, and that's got to be a good thing. Now, I'm going to, in a sense, amplify and build on some of the things that both Pamela and Maximo mentioned. Pamela's point on chronic crisis, Maximo's points on diversification and the need for joined up responses. And I will definitely try and keep to 10 minutes. So my key messages here are that these global crises that keep happening are hugely important because they directly affect so many people. There is still population growth, so more people are being affected by each of these crises as they come along, and especially where they compound each other. However, between what we're seeing or what we recognize as global shocks, the inability of many parts of the world to recover from the last shock and the day-to-day fragility of livelihoods in those places become in themselves part of this chronic crisis scenario. They provided a challenge to future investments. They make it harder for good ideas and innovations to take root. They actually often erode some of the gains that have been made in the past. And so, yes, we have to think about these mega shocks, but they are happening in the context of almost a daily grind of chronic crisis conditions for many households, communities, even countries. And then this requires us, therefore, not just to focus on resilience in agriculture, although that is absolutely essential, but Maximo pointed to the need for multiple entry points into entire food systems with linked up or joined up actions and investments that change things across that system, right? So diversifying diets, not just diversifying production or diversifying trade. And so we've got to try and reduce the risks in what I'm calling here fragile contexts. And I'm going to just focus one slide on this. Fragile contexts. What we're seeing in many parts of the world is growing numbers of people living in contexts defined as fragile. And that's typically a combination of political instability or conflict and or weak governance and or climate change impacts and or COVID effects. And so the number of people in most of the world's poor are already going to be living in what can be classified as fragile context going forward. And that's important. It means that we can no longer think about development in its traditional form of we have a gradual increase in living conditions and well-being. There's a shock that causes disruption, but we go back to normal and carry on that improvement in well-being. We're not seeing that anymore. We're seeing a downward negative spiral. And the fact that more and more of the world's poor are living in these contexts is going to be a real challenge for the international community. It's going to require joined up actions, policy actions, investments in research. We cannot allow a crisis that is mainly talked about in just a few things like two crops, whether it's wheat and vegetable oil or other dimensions like it's the price of fertilizer. We can't let those drive the solution, right? What is needed goes far beyond those two crops or the price of fertilizer. We need actions that are going to allow an amplification of benefits and reduced risks. Yes, in agriculture, but very much also outside of agriculture in rural areas, the livelihood diversification. That requires us to invest heavily in supporting market diversification, the number of players in local markets, not just in global trade, small and medium-term enterprises, allowing entrepreneurs and investors at the local level to bring their expertise and their new ideas and insights to the fore. The whole domain of food transformation, everything between the farm gate and the consumer, offers a lot of opportunity for not just reducing losses and waste, but for improving shelf life and protecting through improved storage the things that have already been produced and are typically lost or wasted in very large amounts. And much of that has to be driven, and Maximo mentioned this, driven by shifts in consumer demand, more informed consumer demand, more empowered consumer demand, which isn't always what we assume it to be. That last point in the discussion that we know a lot about what is produced, we know very little about what people actually eat around the world. And yet we make large global and national policy decisions on the assumption that we know what they eat or what they want to eat. or what they're going to eat in 10 years, which is not the same as 10 years ago. We need to be very careful about how we make these decisions and very careful in how we interdigitate, how we dovetail actions in these different sectors. Maximo mentioned modeling trade-offs. We have to understand those trade-offs very, very well and make sure that we're acting across that food system. Now, we can grow people out of poverty through agriculture as an engine of growth. There's loads of evidence about that. It's not as clear that we can grow people out of crisis. We do need to invest in productivity enhancement with limitations, as Dr. Ratan just said. But we need to also invest in things that will protect, diversify, amplify the demand side, consumption. And part of that comes through ensuring that we understand what are the assets that actually people have. Now, nutritional resilience, it's a thing. People become more resilient to well-nourished children, well-nourished adults were more resilient to the COVID virus than less well-nourished people. Nutritional resilience is important, and that comes through the long term. Diets in the crisis of 2008, for example, in Indonesia, there was a huge impact on rice because of rice prices, lack of accessibility to conventional diets. And yet, I did some work there at that time, the World Bank and Rand Corporation were suggesting, don't worry, there's no real nutritional crisis because children's weight was not declining. But what was happening out of sight was that mothers' weight was significantly declining. They were buffering the calorie consumption of children. But the micronutrient deficiencies of both women and children went through the roof, especially anemia, which impairs cognitive, educational development, labor productivity, and so on. So we have to be very careful. You know, dietary diversity and diet quality is not a luxury. It's part and parcel of making people resilient to the shocks that are affecting them more and more on a daily basis. Part of the solution means let's try and valorize the assets that they have. And we can go into this, I'm not going to go into huge amounts, but there's lots of technologies and new solutions for cutting food loss and waste. We need to amplify what we already have in terms of weather index. But we also need to look at food safety, which actually impairs both health and nutrition of people who eat contaminated foods. Think about more rural banking of the value of livestock before the prices plummet or the cattle all start dying in the next drought. Cash for work, transfers, income transfers of many kinds that can be used on mobile phones, but mainly focused on public goods like market infrastructure development. In a sense, building up the resilience of the rural non-farm economy alongside the farm economy to allow for the food system as a whole to buffer the next storm. So each crisis, each mega crisis is different, but there are common elements in all of them. They all lead to knee-jerk policy reactions like banning exports. And we all know that what knock-on effect that has. More focus on the price of fertilizer rather than the how fertilizer is used or misused. Again, Maximo talked about the gains that we could have from better fine-tuning the use of different fertilizers, not just focused on price. The supply chain disruptions, we have to find ways around that at the global and at the local level. So in a sense, it is a food system-wide problem that demands food system-wide solutions. And we have to take this on seriously. What these global crises are doing, they're not just amplifying each other, they're at least exposing the fragility of our entire food system in ways that we had never really understood until quite recently. So now is the opportunity. Now that people are focused on food again, now that they're focused on food systems and diets and nutrition, not, I won't say again, because that's unusual. It's a unique time where we can join up the humanitarian response with longer term investments that achieve diversification at all levels, at the livelihood level, the production level, the trade level, but especially dietary intake and nutrition, and allow people to have more choice with the assets that they have. And what we can do as an international community is empower them to use value in those assets and amplify their potential for responding to crisis. And I'll stop there and thank you.
Thank you, Patrick. Excellent presentation. Now to share from the humanitarian assistance perspective, I'm pleased to introduce Ms. Sandrine Chettai. Sandrine is the Global Senior Director for Economic Growth at Mercy Corps. Sandrine?
Thank you, Dr. Alexander. Good morning or afternoon. Glad to be with you today. So we've heard alarming summaries of the current situation from Dr. Anderson and Dr. Torero. Let me share you with you a couple more numbers, if I can have the slides, please. All right. All right, well, while we wait for the slide, let me just continue. So 45%, that's the increase in prices of fertilizers and fuel in Ukraine after 2 months of war. 300%, that's the increase in prices of wheat and fuel in Somalia as a result of the drought and the war in Ukraine. 900%, that's the increase in the price of bread in Lebanon as a result of the devaluation of the local currency and the war in Ukraine. I was in front of the BIFAD board 3 years ago, and I talked at that time about the need to define the shock that people are confronted with to be able to build resilience. Well, what we've learned in the past couple of years is that we cannot consider crises by themselves. We cannot talk about increasing resilience to climate shocks like drought in East Africa without also talking about increasing resilience to conflict and economic shocks. So how can we do this? I'm going to talk about Aisha, and you see her on your screen. She lives in Northeast Nigeria, and Aisha grows cowpeas to complement revenues she earns from her petty trade business. Since 2021, she has struggled to make ends meet. Food prices are increasing, seeds, fertilizers, and crop protection products are becoming unavailable. She cannot irrigate her crops any longer with her fuel pump, as it is too expensive. Mercy Corps supported her business with small cash grants to ensure she could maintain her business and income. However, that's not sufficient to help her go through the lingering crises. So Mercy Corps also worked with 20 local input suppliers and transporters to ensure Aisha could access her seeds, better seeds, in the right quantities and at the right time. And we supported 45 copy processors so that they could continue to purchase from Aisha. And we worked with two local banks to develop new small loan products that can support those small businesses in the future. Next slide, please. So why am I talking about Aisha today? Well, her story highlights the complexity of the constraints small businesses have to deal with. For small agribusinesses like Aisha and for all small businesses along the food system, we have a triple mission. We have to help them protect and maintain their assets and income during crisis. We have to help them adapt to the new market conditions. And we have to radically transform the food system so that people like Aisha do not have to go through these rough periods again. Next. So what does that mean to protect and maintain people's asset and income? Well, we need to continue and expand cash responses at scale and make them smarter. So when we supported over 50,000 small businesses like Aisha's in Northeast Nigeria with financial aid and business continuity advice, those small businesses were able to replenish inventories, purchase improved products, diversify their business, and prepare for the next season. But we also made these cash transfers smarter. So what we mean by that is that we used blended finance models where we supported small to medium-sized businesses with grants, and we partnered with local banks. Overall, with an initial investment of $3.5 million, we were able to leverage private investment of $4.6 million and mobilize another $6 million in loans. And I'm talking about Northeast Nigeria during the pandemic. Next. But cash support alone is not sufficient, especially given the length of today's crisis. We need to layer more systemic interventions to ensure people continue to be protected when the next crisis arises. That means encouraging people to increase their savings that can buffer against future shocks. Despite being part of the most marginalized, the people we worked with were able to increase their saving at an average of $72 per individual in less than a year. And we're talking about people who earn less than $1.90 a day. That also means partnering with private insurance companies to develop and provide insurance products adapted to the needs. This is what we're doing in Nigeria, working with Pula Insurance to develop new product and sales models. And by both bolstering savings and promoting insurance, we can help increase people's protection. Next. We should also, when feasible, link with local government social protection schemes so that they can be referred to the government and continue to be supported if their livelihoods are not sufficient. So lessons from our cash consortium in Iraq, for example, has demonstrated that those linkages are possible and beneficial, but need to be thought through at the onset of the project to ensure harmonization in targeting data and other processes. Next. So the second point is that we also need to rethink food systems to make them more adaptable. Another lesson from the COVID crisis is that supply chains are just too long. You know, wheat comes from Ukraine to be consumed in Somalia. This relies on efficient logistics and open borders. So we do need to support and develop food systems that are more local, and can be really the primary sources of food, or at the minimum provide substitutes when supply chain are disrupted. In Nigeria, again, we are supporting food processors to process millet and corn instead of wheat into biscuits and bread. And we work with Flour Mills Nigeria to diversify their sourcing of wheat and spur local production. And of course, all the while, we need to support the diversification of supply and output markets and build redundancies in the market system so that if one fails, we have others to fall back to. In Nigeria, we were working with multiple suppliers of agriculture inputs beyond national borders to help them diversify their sources of input, diversify their transport contract, and diversify their customer base. Next slide. And so the third thing is really to support the transformation of food systems to go beyond adaptation, right? So the current fuel and food crisis provides a unique opportunity to initiate organizational change towards a greener economic agenda. The cost of fuel used for irrigation or processing and the cost and unavailability of chemical fertilizers are very powerful incentives, economic incentives, to change behaviors. We've seen in Jordan under our water savings program that the savings on the cost of fuel, you know, fuel for pumping, were great motivators for producers to invest in water saving technology, much more so than the savings on the cost of water, for example, as water in Jordan is very inexpensive. And so after just 3 years, we helped save over 10 million cubic meters of water. So that's one thing that we can really take advantage of. The other thing, another opportunity in this crisis environment is really to leverage technology. What the COVID crisis has taught us is that people and businesses are extremely resourceful. COVID accelerated the development and uptake of digital solutions as an alternative to face-to-face relationship or transactions. In Nigeria, for example, the digitalization has helped us support supply chain and help them continue to function despite the insecurity and violence. We partner with the Transporter Association to give transporter access to an online platform, which indicates to them the accessible route at any given time. And so this really allows the continuation of the transport of goods and services throughout. Next slide. So what do we draw from all those lessons? First, layer short-term emergency response with longer-term market support. This means using smarter cash responses that leverage additional investment, like our blended finance model in Nigeria. It also means being agile in the funding stream so that we can use funding for emergency or development responses depending on the context at any given time. Next slide. Second is partner with actors across the spectrum. Partnering with a range of partners such as private sector actors and local government will help take full advantage of all the resources in the food system and really trying to build redundancies in support of resilience. Next slide. And so that means the third one is really invest in innovative solutions at scale. And so this means really turning crisis into opportunities, very much the way COVID accelerated the digitalization of markets. The current fuel crisis can help shift practices and help markets become greener. And so donors and government should invest in testing and scaling innovation that catalyze climate resilient solutions and leverage technology. And I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you, Sandrine, for delivering on the humanitarian perspective, a great, great presentation. Now our final panelist for this segment, and last but certainly not least, please welcome Dr. Jamaya Njuki. Jamaya is the chief of the Economic Empowerment Section at UN Women. Welcome, Jamaya, and I'm looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Alexander, and it is an honor for UN Women to participate in this BIFAD meeting, and we thank the board for the invitation. And also thank you to the distinguished speakers who have come before me for those insightful discussions. You've actually laid out the context and the impact very well of this intersection of different crisis, climate and environmental crisis, coupled with conflict, the COVID-19, and how it has accelerated and intensified into a sort of interlinked crisis with huge impacts on our food system. So I won't have to dwell on those numbers that you've already presented, and I can go right into what the implications are for gender inequality for women and girls. So we know the COVID-19 pandemic has really demonstrated that crisis and other, you know, different crises have disproportionate impacts on women and girls. They exacerbate existing inequalities, they threaten jobs and livelihoods, they lay siege to health and well-being, and dramatically increase women's paid work and paid care work, and women's and girls and paid care and domestic work on which our economies and societies depend on. And what this does is it further impedes the resilience and rights of women and girls to adequate food in a changing climate. This is precisely the context we've seen of the war in Ukraine. As UN Women, we have been doing analysis on the impact of some of the things that have been described by the speakers before me and the implications for women and girls around the world. The impacts on food and energy production, prices and availability, and what this means for women and girls' energy access and their rights to food. And we know that even in times of peace, in times of no crisis, which we haven't experienced in a while now, that women do tend to be more food insecure than men. And these crises really just entrench some of these gender inequalities, often meaning that women and girls eat less. I think, Patrick, you alluded to that earlier. And that their nutritional needs may actually be sidelined as they take care of everybody, further deepening hunger, malnutrition, and poverty for these groups. But this crisis, these interlinked crises, in a way, providers an opportunity, because it does feel like we are sitting at a crossroad, facing the choice between doubling down on the mistakes of the past or seizing the opportunity to actually do things differently. And from a perspective of gender equality, the impact on women and girls, allow me to outline 5 priorities that I think we need to focus on that will help us prepare for future crises, but also build resilient economies and food systems that work for women and girls. One is, let's prioritize jobs. Women's access to decent jobs, to social protection and livelihoods needs to be ensured as part of a people-centered economy that actually addresses inequalities between and within countries, while promoting the right to food, food security and nutrition. So we talk a lot about just and green transitions. We need to make sure that these transitions are not just green transitions, but they are also gender just green transitions, which we must harness to create decent jobs for women, whether it's in care, whether it's in energy, in agriculture, or natural resource management. And universal gender responsive social protection systems need to be strengthened to provide a bulwark against economic and environmental shocks, and address the specific risks and challenges that women and girls face, including their access to food, as has been highlighted by previous crises and conflicts. The second thing we must do is we need to prioritize gender-responsive climate action and sustainable food system transitions. The need to adopt sustainable and climate-resilient food and energy systems and approaches has actually never been more urgent. We cannot revert to business as usual in the response and recovery. As the Secretary General has highlighted in our common agenda, we must shift from economies that are dependent on fossil fuels to ones that are low emission and climate resilience, and to ones that put women and girls at the center. UN Women's experience in this field has shown that strengthening resilience requires an integrated approach that addresses the structural barriers that women farmers face within the context of a changing climate. We have a UN Women's Climate Resilience Agriculture Program that is combining innovative approaches to promote gender-just transitions in key sectors, including work on agroecology, working and to strengthen women's land rights and tenure security, improve their access to markets and information, as well as time and labor-saving technologies. We are collaborating with their own-based agencies, FAO, IFAD, and WFP, to really focus on the economic empowerment of rural women. The third priority is, let's prioritize women's leadership and participation, including feminist leadership. We know around the world, girls and women are not just vulnerable, but they're taking action to build resilient economies and food systems at all levels. 2 years ago, I led the process of getting gender and women's empowerment central to the UN Food Systems Summit. And it was very clear about all the actions that women are taking. But very often, their voice, their agency, their participation continues to be underreported, under-resourced, undervalued, and under-recognized. Yet we know, and there is evidence, that promoting women's and girls' full and equal participation and leadership is key to making our food systems more effective and more resilient. The fourth thing I would say we prioritize, which is often very overlooked when we talk about food systems, is care. Public investments in the care economy should be a key pillar to economic recovery and women's empowerment, including for improving food security and nutrition. Affordable quality care services are not only critical to support women's re-entry into the labor force and for the well-being of children and older persons, But we know that investments in care can drive job-rich, resilient economies and recovery. We are investing a lot of time and resources jointly with other UN agencies in this. We are working with UN, with ILO to address the issue of the disproportionate burden of unpaid care, and especially post COVID, through promoting decent employment for women through inclusive growth policies and investments in the care economy with governments around the world. We are integrating care and investments in care on climate resilience, our climate resilience work. Working with farmers' cooperatives, for example, in Rwanda, Senegal, and South Africa, to include provisions of childcare services, early childhood education, access to time-saving infrastructure and services. And we hope that we can start seeing much better mainstreaming of work around care in a lot of the interventions on climate resilience. Lastly, we need to prioritize gender statistics to understand, track, and better address the disproportionate impacts on women and girls and gender diverse persons. We need to improve and invest in disaggregated data in this gender environment nexus so that this can provide the basis for informed policies and programs for gender responsive food systems. We are all in collaboration with a lot of organizations and with support from USAID on a Women Count program that is just doing this. And it's a primary resource for data now, revealing the disproportionate impact of COVID-19 on women and girls, but really providing data that others can use to inform policy and programming. To conclude, I'll say all this requires that we have transformative macroeconomic policies that around which all this is hinged. We know that achieving gender equality and the empowerment of all women and girls is critical to this agenda to achieve a sustainable, equitable, and peaceful world that we know we all want to build. And we have the evidence to actually do this. And what's left of us is really to seize this opportunity of collaboration, solidarity, and renewed multilateralism that puts women and girls at the center. So again, let me reiterate, prioritize jobs, gender responsive climate action, feminist leadership, address the unpaid care burden on women and girls, and gender statistics. And as UN Women, we stand ready to partner with others around the world to make this a reality. Thank you.
Jemima, thank you for your excellent presentation. I would like to, at this time, open the floor to my fellow BIFAD members to see if they will share some reflections or questions for the panel. And I know we said you could have questions for Patrick, Sandrine, or Jemima at this time. And I'm going to call on our BIFAD panelists. Kathy?
I have an observation that I would love Patrick and Sandrine to comment on, which is acknowledging that today's meeting's focus is on agriculture and on food systems. I really appreciate the recognition in the presentations about the need for a multi-sectoral approach and the need for involving the humanitarian sector. What I didn't hear as much about was the need to invest in the health sector if we're going to build resilience in these areas. Malnutrition has such a devastating impact on growth and on health, and I know Patrick is well versed in all of this, but the health system can play such a vital role in preventing malnutrition and everything that's going to follow from that and in treating it. So I just wondered if either of you would want to comment on that.
Thank you, Kathy. We're going to go ahead and collect the other questions and come back to them all at once. So hang on, panelists, for just a moment while we go to Henri. Any questions?
Yes. Working for two corporations, you know, it's really important to have that hand in hand in public and corporate partnerships. Are there some recommendations? Have you seen things that work really well between corporations and organizations that can really move the needle on some of this work?
Thank you, Henri. Mm-hmm. Suwede?
Yes, so thank you, Dr. Alexander, and I'll apologize for not being able to put on my video and respond earlier. My connection is quite poor here. I wanted to appreciate all the speakers, and I just wanted, I'm not sure who might want to reflect on this, but it might be Patrick or even Sandrine, but I was intrigued in what your thoughts are about the role of research. So Maximo showed a map that documented that in many parts of the globe, and particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, you know, commodities like wheat might be a small share of the budget or might account for a small, you know, share in consumption of even the starchy staples. And so, yes, it's great that we have these demand side studies that help us to understand consumption patterns if we're able to understand the trade-offs that households are making between different kinds of foods. And oftentimes I saw several of the policy recommendations around, you know, opening up borders and you know, thinking about past responses of governments. And I guess I'm wondering, what is the role of research in ensuring that governments don't quickly have a knee-jerk reaction, such as diverting all the attention to wheat, for example, or something like that, when this might not be the most effective use of resources, given the importance of, say, wheat or one commodity in the budget, or the food budget of the household, or in the consumption basket of the household. So I would just be interested in any of the responses of the speakers about the role of research in guiding policymakers and being able to make appropriate responses with their own particular context in mind. Thank you.
Thanks, Ueda. Ratan?
Thank you. I have a specific question for Jemima Jacob. In sub-Saharan Africa, where 70% of the small landholder farmers are women, the yield gap is by a factor of 2 to 4. What can be attained and what actually is can be go up by 3-4 times. Same thing applies to many other places. What particular strategy do you suggest to empower small landholders, especially farmers, who can translate the existing scientific knowledge into action and enhance food production? It's not a question of new research, it's a question of translating existing knowledge into action, and what role can be played by policymakers in empowering small farmers, especially women?
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Ratan. Marie Boyd's question deals with our briefing materials for this meeting that speak to creating resilient food systems that can respond to future crises and shocks. What evidence is there on how resilient food systems can help to prevent or mitigate future shocks and crises? And then we'll move to Pamela, and then we will allow our panelists in order to respond. Pamela?
Thank you, Lawrence. Patrick, would you say a few more words to us about your point on valorizing smallholders' assets, and particularly, what do you see? Do you have any insights into what the obstacles and challenges are to doing more of that? And sorry, I'm going to throw in another one here. Jemima, what would you like to see? I know you said you're collaborating with USAID, but what would it look like for you to strengthen that collaboration? What would you like to be doing more of with USAID? Thanks, Lawrence.
Thank you, Pamela. Let's go in that order, Patrick, Sandrine, and Jemima. Patrick?
Of course, I, having become digital, didn't have a pen and paper to hand, so you may need to nudge me as I go along here. So first of all, health. Absolutely right, Kathy. I'll just give one example. One of the biggest humanitarian challenges is not just reaching people with any old food, right? We've learned the BHA and WFP, they're not trying to just, as in the bad old days, you know, dump sacks of grain. They're trying to deliver tailored food baskets, essentially diversified diets, to the people who most need them, and for a good reason, because they need to maintain or recover their nutritional resilience. One of the biggest challenges in humanitarian work is to treat wasting, is to stop people from dying, mainly children, but sometimes adults, from dying, as you know, from what is a preventable condition. 15, maybe 75 million kids wasted at any given time, let alone during a major crisis. And the cost of doing that is extremely high, but of course it has to be done to save children's lives. But I'm just finishing some work for a review for WHO on the role of health issues like malaria and diarrheal disease in relation to the incidence and prevalence of wasting. And it's, as you would expect, extremely high. Kids who are in a condition where malaria is endemic and diarrheal disease is normal are much more likely to get wasted and die of wasting, and therefore makes the treatment harder. So if nothing else, that shows that the prior health services, the quality of those services, the conditions, matters immensely to whatever else goes on the food side of the food system. So yes, let's bring these sectors to the table together. On research, there's nothing stopping governments taking knee-jerk reactions because they're not actually usually listening very closely to evidence or science. But the one area where they probably will listen is with the economics, is better understanding of economic trade-offs, this action versus that action, or the economic cost of inaction. If you don't do something quickly, here's the cost to your budget, to your government, to your people. And so making choices starker in terms of implications of the choices that they're going to make anyway may help, may save some lives, may save some resources. We have to think about how best to deal with that. Can you nudge me just very quickly, Dr. Alexander, on what other questions were pointed my way?
There was another question on speak to the health system and how the vital role in preventing malnutrition. And there was a question specific to you.
There was Pamela's at the end.
Pamela's question.
Yeah. To please help us understand, if you have insights on valorizing.
So much, you know, as many of you know, I used to work for WFP as chief of nutrition and was very much involved with mega shocks like the Asian tsunami or the Haiti earthquake and so on. And so much effort goes into saving people's lives and trying to put something back that was there before. There's almost never enough time or resource to, instead of building back better, building forward better, and thinking what kinds of investments could be made to enhance local assets. And most people rely on diversified portfolio of incomes. They're not just farmers, and I don't mean that in any negative sense. Most people in low-income countries are, even farmers, are net purchasers of food. We have to find ways to increase the diversity of options, income-earning options in rural areas, not that are not farm-based, but that generate demand for farm produce. If you want short chains, short supply chains and local food systems, you have to generate more effective demand for more diversified produce locally. And so that requires not just a focus on the ag side, what goes on the fields, but the things that are going on around the fields, right? Different jobs. So that's mostly going to be in service type jobs, small and medium enterprises that are doing all kinds of value chain work in food and non-food commodities, in targeting resources, so rural finance that helps people invest in the assets they have. I mentioned then better banking of livestock value before that value disappears and dies. Better rural finance to protect consumption. Consumption financing has been tried in the past and then has disappeared. We need to know why some of those novel ideas of the past didn't take off. And let's not forget people's local knowledge, their learning, right? So it's livestock, land, and real learning. And they have knowledge to build on. They often don't have resources to valorize that and need simply to be enabled to do that, right? I'm being very generic because we're out of time. But we need to think differently to intervene differently. And that is about enhancing people's assets to build on and build forward better rather than build back what there was before. Over.
Thank you, Patrick. I wanted to give Sandrine and Jemima an opportunity.
Yeah, thank you. So very briefly, I think on the importance of health systems, that's a great call. And I would suggest that there is more coordination and between the health system and the agriculture system. We're acting still very much in silos. But if we can bring those two systems together, for example, you know, in countries you have health extension systems that are much stronger than the agriculture or vice versa, and how can we build on those strengths to pass, you know, nutrition messages or health messages that are critical. Very much so in a similar way with insurance. You know, we talk about agriculture insurance, and we know that people are not very likely to pay for agriculture insurance, and they will be more likely to pay for health insurance. And so how can we then combine those two systems just to make sure that we have, you know, we have something that works for the people that we can help serve? So really trying to bridge those two systems, I think, would be would go a long way to move us in the right direction. In response to the question on cooperation, I think we've had some great learning and we made great stride with partnering with private cooperation. I think making sure that, you know, and now is very apropos with the World Economic Forum going on currently. So again, just trying to make sure that those corporations are interested in investing in those very fragile contexts, you know, just combine efforts with the international development community and the local government to find the appropriate solution. Because, you know, actors like Mercy Corps, we can support in really developing the supply chain. We have boots on the ground, we know the context. How can we support those big corporations really increase their supply chain that will be beneficial for the people that we support? So we've had some great example of strengthening those supply chain, you know, with Walmart in Latin America or with coffee, et cetera. So definitely something that we want to explore further. And maybe just on the question from Mary on the evidence on how resilient food system can help prevent and mitigate future shocks. It seems that we have strong evidence right now of, you know, what type of interventions or collaboration can support resilience to and prevent future shock when we talk about climate specifically, or when we talk about conflict specifically. So I think we've developed over the years those evidence to a certain shocks. What we don't know yet, it's the evidence of the combined shocks, right? And I think that's where we are today, is how do we build resilience overall to the myriad of shocks that can actually happen. So I think that's where we really have the gap. And I'll stop there just to make sure that Dr. Jemima has the time to answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandrine. Jemima?
Thank you so much for those questions. First, on the issue of this gap in productivity between what we call women-owned or women-managed firms and other firms, we know are a huge contributor to those gaps is gaps in technology access, as well as gaps in labor availability. And so we know what is causing those gaps, and we need to figure out how to close those gaps. And we do also have some evidence of what works in terms of, for example, working with women smallholder farmers through cooperatives, through groups, to make sure that they have access to information and that they have access to technologies. But there's also other gaps that we need to close at a more global scale. Every meeting I'm in, we talk about the potential for digital technologies, the digital platforms in terms of engaging smallholder farmers and ensuring they have the right resources. But we also know that we have some global gaps on access to digital technologies. And so if we're not first closing that gap, if we then are going ahead to use digital tools to get to information, there's a potential that we actually widen some of the gaps that we see. So we need to be much more intentional in terms of how we are deploying technologies and resources to smallholder farmers, keeping in mind some of these gaps and that we are not widening them, and first closing some of those gaps where they exist. The second thing I would say is we need to start from smallholder farmers. They've been farming, they've been providing. They really understand what their constraints are. Somebody had put in the comments that this parachuting of technologies to smallholder farmers is not going to work because those technologies need to be adapted to their systems. They need to be adapted to their resource base. And there is a point at which we need to recognize that. I worked with the Innovation Lab on mechanization when it first started, and it was so gratifying to see them saying, of course we know mechanization works. We know that these technologies exist, but if we're going to work in sub-Saharan Africa, we need to start with those farmers and understand what their needs and priorities are. And as a result, the innovations that have come out of that lab are very different from what we would have seen if it was a technology transfer process. So they're investing in research on mechanization to thresh beans, which wouldn't have been a priority in the global scheme of ideas around mechanization. So we really need to start from smallholder farmers themselves. The second question on what USAID needs to do more of. I know USAID has invested a lot, as I said, in data. The Feed the Future has had gender and women's empowerment at the center of it, including investing in measurement using the Women Empowerment in Agriculture Index. So two key things that I'll say that we need to double down on, if I may say so, is making sure that all our programming is really meaningfully integrate gender and a focus on the empowerment of women and girls. And that can mean so many things. It can mean that there's actually specific investments, financial investments that are being made in making sure that programs are reaching women and girls. So making sure there's budgetary provisions for this to happen, that it's not just being said in words, that those commitments, those you know, verbal commitments are translating into financial commitments. So that's mainstreaming, whether it's in climate action or other interventions. The second thing is very specific investments on strategic issues around gender equality and the empowerment of women and girls. And I'll give you an example. We've talked about gender and climate change for so long, about the fact that women and girls are affected in different ways by the climate change crisis, that we need to put investments in women and girls. Up to today, we still don't have a Women in Climate Fund that ensures that resources are going directly to organizations that are working on women and girls or working on issues of women and girls. There is still a huge financing gap that mainstreaming hasn't fixed. And so it is going to require specific investments in some of those areas to ensure that we are actually getting to the objective of making sure women and girls are becoming resilient, or we are solving the energy crisis for them, or we are solving the fuel crisis for women and girls. So very, very specific investments that are needed there, and in other areas that I can mention, but due to time, we can follow up a conversation on this.
Sure, thank you, Jemima. And we'd like to thank our BIFAD members and the panelists for that discussion. We'd like to turn to at least a couple of questions from our audience. And we're gonna ask our panelists to keep their responses brief, maybe to 1 minute or less, if that is possible. It's a question directly for Maximo from Ahmed Kaplan at USAID. What does the picture look like if we take into account food loss and waste in countries affected most by the Russian invasion? Additionally, are data available on the impact of the current crisis on non-commodity food crops, mainly perishables?
Thank you for the question. I tried to answer it through the question and answer, but the problem right now, when we talk about food loss and waste, I don't think we should focus only on those countries because those are the most vulnerable countries. No, we are talking of countries which are really import dependent and they have significant budget constraints right now. Now, if we look at overall reduction of food loss and waste, for example, if we reduce food loss and waste in 50%, there will be sufficient fruits and vegetables available in the food supply to cover the recommended diet of vegetables and fruits per person per day. So the gains are substantial. Now, in some of these countries which are import dependent, in North Africa, for example, the problem is behavior. No? If you go to Egypt and you want to abruptly change the consumption of bread, it will take time. It's not something that you can do overnight. And the country is very inelastic to respond to that because of what happened in the Arab Spring. So I wouldn't argue that we should focus on those countries. I think we should focus across the board. In terms of the second part of the question of high value commodities versus staple commodities, the problem we are observing is very difficult to separate the different elements. What we know today is how much the import bill has increased in those countries. And that we can calculate for food. So for the food that they use to import, we know how much their import bill has increased because of the crisis. And that we have quantified, and that's why we are proposing this food financing facility to cover that gap for the most vulnerable countries. So that we have. Now, we cannot decompose right now that by different types of products. We just look at the overall import bill. But we have data that could allow us to do that, but that's something to go in more detail further. But at this point, we know the overall food import bill.
Thank you. We have another question, and this is for our panelists. We're gonna go in reverse order, starting with Jemima. There seems to be a dilemma. The current Ukraine crisis is caused mainly by one bad actor. Many food crises are caused by bad political decisions. Scientists and development workers are hard pressed to clean up after such bad actions. Question, does the international community have a responsibility to be more proactive in combating such bad actors and bad action? That doesn't mean that scientists and development workers can stand down, but it may recognize that they can't, quote, win the battle, end quote, without the needed political actions. We go from Jemima to Sandrine and then Patrick.
That's a tough question.
And keep your responses to a minute if you will, please.
That's a really tough one. But I think the first thing to say is yes, the international community does have an obligation to support, but also to hold governments accountable for some of these actions. And I know at the UN level that's happening. One of the things I'll say is that the Secretary General has formed a global crisis response group that as UN Women, we sit on, that's looking at the impact of the war on food, energy, and finance. And on the finance side, I know there's a lot of actions being taken in the short term, in the medium and long term to actually respond to the crisis. But really just an agreement with that comment that the global community does have a huge role to play in this. As soon as the crisis hit UN Women with Care, we did some rapid analysis to already see what the impact on women and girls are. We are reorganizing a lot of our programming in Ukraine and the neighboring countries in order to respond to this. And I know a lot of other UN agencies are responding in similar ways.
Yes, I'm not sure I have more to add. That's a great response. Definitely the need to hold those responsible accountable. And this is where we definitely need to join forces with, you know, the humanitarian community like ours, with the donors, and see how collectively we can put pressure and advocate for some of those decisions. I think by one way of doing that is documenting as much as possible some of the impact, as Dr. Nyugi mentioned. So thanks.
So yes, great. Research that documents not just the impact, but the costs, the unintended consequences, essentially, of various policy actions. It still needs to be done. It still needs to be brought together. And we, you know, when we are talking crises, we tend to go back to 2007, often forgetting the mid 90s, 94, 96. There was a major world food price spike in the mid 90s. That there was a UN emergency group brought together. Where things failed, from my perspective, on the international accountability front, is the collapse of the Uruguay round and the fact that we need WTO or something else to take on agriculture and food issues in the way that we're talking about them. That was the intention of WTO way back when, but it doesn't, and it never has, and now there's nothing. It's a vacuum. So if we have any lessons, then that would be one to take away, is to promote politically the international community to create the body and the forum for dialogue that would allow for this kind of learning and accountability mechanisms for policy actions that are destructive or damaging to other people.
Thank you. Thank you, Patrick. Please join me in thanking all of our invited panelists and speakers. Did an excellent job. We appreciate your contributions to this discussion today and to the work of the BIFAD going forward. Let's transition now to an exciting announcement from my colleague and fellow BIFAD member, Professor Atan Lal of The Ohio State University, and our invited guest, Anne Vaughn, Senior Advisor on Climate Change in USAID Bureau for Resilience and Food Security.
Dr. Alexander, did you want me to make comments now?
Yes.
Thank you. I really appreciate the opportunity, and I'll be very brief. I understand we are a little bit behind time. Just to give a background, 700 gigaton of carbon has been emitted by human activity since 1750, 66% from fossil fuel, 34% from land use change. While 45% of all that remained in the atmosphere, 30% were absorbed by the land-based sinks. Therefore, a very important question is, what can be done to increase the strength capacity of the land-based sink in addition to finding non-carbon fuel sources? And the importance of land-based sink is that because the food, nutritional security, water quality, biodiversity, many other ecosystem services depend on the land-based sink. Therefore, given the priority of the agency and the Biden-Harris administration, when BIFAD met with Administrator Samantha Power and senior USAID leadership earlier in the year, the administrator's first point of business was to request that BIFAD advise USAID on responding to systemic risks brought about by climate change in agriculture, food system, and nutrition. In other words, she gave us a mandate to find climate resilient or climate friendly agriculture in such a way that agriculture becomes a solution to the problem. In that context, I'm very pleased to announce today that BIFAD plans to take up this call to action and to elevate and accelerate work in this area. Central to our response is the commissioning of a study on systemic solutions to climate change adaptation and mitigation in agriculture, nutrition, and food systems. In farmer consultation with a broad range of experts, this study will expand the transdisciplinary expertise in this area to advise BIFAD, which can in turn provide USAID with independent recommendations that will enable USAID to improve programming in this area. Therefore, the study will draw upon expertise from program implementers, researchers, and the private sector with a plan to engage over 40 experts globally. The key outcomes of this study will be to inform priority focus areas in USAID's research portfolio and to summarize and share evidence about the interlinkages among climate change, food security, poverty, malnutrition reduction, natural resource management, and the land use planning in developing countries. The study will advance specifically two objectives. Objective number one, it will evidence-based recommendation to support USAID's role in accelerating system change and transformative climate change adaptation and mitigation approaches in agriculture, food systems, and nutrition in line with the US government global food security strategy, USAID's climate strategy, and other sectoral policies. The objective number two of this study will be evidence-based recommendation to support USAID's role in targeting climate finance to benefit smallholders. That's a point that we were discussing just a few minutes ago. And the evidence and recommendation provided this study will position the board to advise USAID on how to accelerate climate change action to program to achieve climate change adaptation and mitigation targets, agricultural productivity growth, inclusive food systems, and poverty and malnutrition reduction. The study consultation effort will launch this month and will include public workshop leading up to the COP27. BIFAD eagerly supports this work and will encourage the study of authors to work diligently but quickly to put forward evidence-based recommendations ahead of the Conference of Parties, COP27, in November of this year. We invite the attendees here today and your networks to join in the future public discussion to help inform this critically important work. I thank you, Dr. Alexander, for your leadership today, and thank all those who participated. Personally, I'm looking forward to this study. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ratan. It is an honor to serve with you on the board. Your leadership and vision in climate change space will help to guide the BIFAD's important work going forward. Now I'm very pleased to welcome Ann Vaughn, a senior advisor for climate change in USA Bureau for Resilience and Food Security. Ann?
Thanks so much, Dr. Alexander. And I will be very quick because I think Professor Lal said it best. We really need collective action. to solve the climate crisis. And at AID, and we'll go to the next slide already. At AID, we're working to prevent the worst impacts of the climate crisis by working with governments and communities around the world to mitigate against and adapt to climate change impacts that are already happening now. We've got several foundational strategies that are giving us direction on how to address the threat of climate change to our food systems. But we need your help, as Professor Lal was noting, in helping making sure that that we are incorporating food systems into our thinking. So we've got these three strategies that will help us think through food systems work. But next slide, please. To flag for everyone, I think a lot of folks know here, we've got the US Global Food Security Strategy. It includes a new intermediate result on climate change that's right in the center of the slide. If you click forward, it'll circle it, I believe, that talks about how we're going to enhance climate change adaptation and mitigation. That's incredibly important, but our food security work has already taken into consideration shocks and stresses from climate for years. And you'll see some of the old IRs that, if you're real familiar with the GFSS, Global Food Security Strategy, it's not new because we know climate change has been impacting food systems for a very long time, but we are redoubling our efforts. And we think it's really important to have the specific intermediate results on enhancing climate change adaptation and mitigation that we hope the study will really help us think through and be able to enact. So next slide, please. I'm gonna have to click through those, sorry. We were trying to be creative with our graphics. But the next slide is highlighting our USAID climate strategy that was launched in April on Earth Day. And the climate strategy's vision is to achieve a resilient, prosperous, and equitable world with net zero emissions. It's a whole of agency effort that will guide our actions through 2030. And we're setting our most ambitious timelines and targets ever for reducing global emissions, increasing people's resilience, mobilizing climate finance, and working for equitable, inclusive outcomes. We've developed six targets. You can read them up here. The ones that I think we hope the study will most focus on and help us address will be on adaptation, some of the mitigation actually across all of these targets, as well as mobilizing $150 billion in dollars in private finance. Our climate strategy complements and is advancing an important presidential initiative that is transforming also how we approach climate adaptation. As hopefully you heard back at COP26, President Biden launched the President's Emergency Plan for Adaptation and Resilience, or PREPARE, which brings together the diplomatic development and technical expertise of the US to support more than 500 million people in developing countries adapt to and manage the impacts of climate change by 2030. We know addressing food security and increasing the ability of vulnerable communities to adapt to and feed themselves in a warming world is an essential part of PREPARE. USAID is co-leading PREPARE with the State Department and playing a central role in implementing PREPARE, utilizing our longstanding on-the-ground partnerships to strengthen the climate resilience of governments and communities through sustainable development and humanitarian assistance. But to achieve the targets that have laid out in this, the food security strategy, the climate strategy targets you see up here and in PREPARE, we really need help from a whole wide range of stakeholders. And we're really excited about BIFAD commissioning this study that will look at transformational change of food systems, including helping get more climate finance to smallholder farmers. First, I think it's really important for the study to look at when we talk about systems change and transformation. It's really easy to talk about, it's hard to do. And we're hoping the study will provide some concrete, very concrete recommendations on how the USAID can help make food systems ready for a warming world and find ways to reduce food systems' impact on climate. Second, we need help on climate finance, as we've talked about. Despite agriculture's vulnerability to climate change, the total amount of climate finance allocated to ag, forestry, and other land use is just a small fraction of what's needed. Only about 3% of the total tracked global finance goes towards agriculture. And as a global community, we need help focus on fixing these gaps. We're doing it, as you can see again, by setting some ambitious targets like our finance target on the screen. We're also working with USDA and State Department on the Agricultural Innovation Mission for Climate, or AIM4C, which was announced at COP. I'll drop a link in the chat for folks to check it out, but encourage non-government and private sector partners to partner with us through AIM4C to help galvanize private sector investments in climate smart food systems. Turning back to today's exciting announcement about this important study, we're thrilled to be getting the help of these renowned experts to help solve the dual problems of adapting to climate change and mitigating the impacts on food system, and making sure smallholder farmers can have the access and right amount of finance to face the glowing challenges of feeding their families and the planet. Again, we encourage the public to participate in this, in these different events leading up to the development of the study. And thanks again for this exciting support from BIFAD to help tackle this important challenge. Back to you, Professor.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anne, for that excellent report. And we are running just a tad short on time today. So we are going to move forward and thank all of our participants today for the lively and thoughtful engagement in the chat and Q&A with our speakers and other members. You know, public consultation, transparent exploration of the evidence, and collaboration with stakeholders are fundamental pillars of the BIFAD's work to help us reflect upon and synthesize the discussion and presentations today. I'm honored to welcome BIFAD member Henri Moore. Henri?
Well, I can honestly say there is no way I can condense this into a short, coherent presentation. But what I did try to really capture were, you know, how can we move forward? So we heard Administrator Powers talk about the launching of Feed the Future in 2008 and the important work being done in those, in the Feed the Future Innovation Labs for novel solutions. That will be really important. We heard Maximo really focus on the extent and the magnitude of the current crisis, but he also said we had a window of opportunity and we need to look at how we can provide incentives through the demand side rather than the direct incentives to producers that may be, you know, not cost efficient or less cost efficient. We heard Patrick talk about the solutions require us to approach this with a food systems wide approach and with linked up solutions, because we're going to grow from 1.8 billion to 2.3 billion by 2030. We need to focus on the fertilizer price versus how fertilizer is used. We heard Sandrine talk about the layering short-term emergency response with longer-term market support, partnering with actors across the entire spectrum, both private and local governments, invest in innovative solutions at scale. And then, you know, we need more coordination between health and agriculture systems because that work is being done in silos. And last but not least, Jemima spoke to my heart because when I was at Corteva AgriScience, one of our pillars was empowering women, because we know if we can lift women and girls, you raise the whole family. And so this work needs to really start with smallholder farmers, because you can't just parachute technology in, you've got to make it adaptable to the local technology. We need to prioritize jobs for women. We need to strengthen women's land rights and land tenure across markets. We need to prioritize women's leadership and participation, because we will make food systems more effective and more resilient because we're women and that's what we do. We make things work and we stretch. We need public investment and we need to improve the data because it will really help to inform policies. And we all have a role in this, whether it's a company. My new company, Haleon, will be a consumer healthcare company. And we are focusing our efforts on health inclusivity in underserved communities. And, you know, that includes nutrition, education of how, you know, to eat and live healthy. So this was really a great opportunity to listen to wonderful experts, and I really appreciate the opportunity to be able to kind of give to capsulize everything so that we know where we're going in the future. So thanks very much, Dr. Alexander, for the opportunity.
Henri, thank you. That was a great summary and great overview of just about everything we did today. we appreciate that. I did want to mention that we did not have time to take lots more in the way of questions, but we do want you to continue to submit those questions in the Q&A and in the comments and chat section, so that we're going to encourage our speakers to respond to those as well in the chat in the time that is remaining. I want to add in closing remarks today that this was the BIFAD's, this new BIFAD's first public meeting. We once again thank everyone for joining us today. This was a very big step in the evidence gathering portion of the BIFAD's work. We hope to continue coming together around this issue as we continue to put together evidence-based solutions to the issues surrounding poverty and hunger and all the other issues. As a reminder, we look forward to posting official minutes of these proceedings on the USAID's BIFAD website following this event. And please know that your comments and questions will form a part of the official public record and will be considered in BIFAD's recommendations to the administrator. As I said, this has been a great day, a great meeting here today. And I'd like to thank again all of our speakers and panelists from today, and also those who helped to organize this event, including BIFAD Executive Director Clara Cohen, and the BIFAD Support Contract Team, including Senior Counselor Carmen Benson, Operations Manager Carol Chan, Project Manager Mary Beggs, Contract Support Megan Knight, Climate Change Specialist Raheel Diro, and the technical team working behind the scenes. Thank you so very much from the bottom of our hearts. Did an excellent and outstanding job in assisting us to put on this work today. Everyone, it takes lots of hands to put on a production such as this, and everyone who came in were very supportive and did an outstanding job in assisting us in getting this program afloat today. So at this time, we have come to the end of our very first BIFAD public meeting. We thank you all again for joining us today. And with no further business to conduct, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.